My name is Lisa Nadasu Smith. I'm the professor of biological anthropology at the University of Otago. And today I'm going to be talking to you about human evolution and how initially genetics and nowadays genomics are really helping us to reconstruct human migrations and understand human evolution, in particular, making us really rethink some of the ideas that we had about human evolution and the relationship between Homo sapiens and some of our closest ancestors, for example, the Neanderthal. So we'll be talking today about broadly about human migration and ultimately how that relates to human variation that we see across the globe today. So traditionally, when we look and think about human evolution, we think about fossil evidence. And this was the way that we really started to understand our place in time and in terms of evolution by looking at fossil remains, the remains of crania and postcranial skeleton, to look at the changes in the characteristics that ultimately make humans who we are. So we look at characteristics like increased cranial capacity and the size of our brain case, the changes that are associated with our facial shape, which are related to dentition and diet, and of course the changes associated with being a hominin in the first place, which really is defined by our ability to walk bipedally. And so we know from the fossil evidence, of course, that our earliest hominin ancestors, the Australopithecines, for example, existed exclusively in Africa. So human origins are traced to Africa. So we all ultimately came out of Africa, but there have been multiple out of Africa migrations. The first out of Africa migration really began about 2 million years ago with Homo erectus. Possibly some Homo habilis, and as you'll probably be reading, there's lots of debate about how we classify these early hominins. But we know that Homo erectus, or something similar to Homo erectus, leaves Africa about 2 million years ago. We see remains in Georgia, in Europe, in southern Europe, dated to about 1.8 million years ago. And we see that Homo erectus reaches East Asia. We have Peking man, Homo erectus in China, dated to about 1.4 million years ago, and around a million years ago. In Java and Eugene Dubois and the Java Man. So that was really the first out of Africa migration. And there were many, many debates, of course, as a result of this fossil evidence as to what was the relationship between those Homo erectus populations in Europe and Asia and Africa with the modern populations living in those regions today. And there were two theories that were presented, really. In the 1980s, the out of Africa, a replacement model, and a model that really, from the fossil evidence, appeared to be the stronger of the two, called the regional continuity model. And the regional continuity model argued that Homo erectus left Africa and moved across the globe, or the old world, Europe and Asia, Africa, Europe, and Asia, and evolved in those locations into modern Homo sapiens. And so Asian Homo erectus evolved into Asian Homo sapiens, European Homo erectus evolved into European Homo sapiens, African Homo erectus evolved into African Homo sapiens, and that there was gene flow between those populations so that there was no speciation event. They all belonged to the same species and were evolving through time. And they based that on the fact that there were certain cranial characteristics, for example, that we see in Asian erectus, the shape of the skull, the shape of the teeth, for example, that are very similar characteristics that we see in Asian populations today, and same for Africa and European populations. And up until really the mid-1980s, the replacement model that Homo sapiens, Homo erectus left Africa and went into Asia and Europe, but that basically Homo sapiens evolved in Africa and then emerged out as a second out of Africa migration, and that African Homo sapiens replaced these earlier erectus or earlier hominin populations in Europe and in Asia. And the thing that really changed our perspective, I suppose, was when genetics kind of entered the picture of human evolution. And this really is tied back to the research of a New Zealand scientist who was actually based in working at the University of California at Berkeley, a man by the name of Alan Wilson, who's actually one of New Zealand's greatest scientists and somebody I think who, unfortunately, most New Zealanders don't know enough about. But Alan Wilson, say, was born in Ngarawahia. He got his undergraduate degree in zoology and biochemistry at the University of Otago, and then he went to the United States to do his PhD, which he ultimately obtained from the University of California at Berkeley, and he ended up teaching at UC Berkeley until his untimely death in 1991. And Alan's lab really was the premier lab in developing the field of molecular evolution, molecular anthropology. While people were talking in the 1960s and 70s about the molecular clock, it was Alan's lab that actually generated the data that proved the concept of the molecular clock, that DNA sequences or molecular sequences changed at a constant rate through time. We could use those molecular differences to, in a sense, work out an evolutionary time frame of species, of speciation, and differentiation of different populations. Alan's lab really demonstrated the value of mitochondrial DNA, which I'll talk about in a minute, and in particular for understanding evolution within a species. And it was Alan's lab, of course, that also really pioneered the field of ancient DNA. Most of the major ancient DNA labs can kind of trace their ancestry back to Alan Wilson and the Wilson lab. What Alan did was recognized that rather than working from the past, working from fossil material, and trying to reconstruct how we got to where we are today, he flipped that thinking on its head. And he said, you know, we don't know that all of those fossils had descendants. So we know, for example, that when we look at the fossil hominid tree, that many of those fossils are evolutionary dead ends. The robust australopithecines, for example, didn't produce anything that still exists today. They were an evolutionary dead end. We think maybe ultra specialized for a particular kind of diet. But what he said is, you know, we all know, all living people today have ancestors, and we carry that ancestral DNA in our DNA. It gets passed on. We inherited it from our parents, and they inherited it from their parents, and so forth. So we could actually look, starting with genetic variation today, and reconstruct backwards. So say you flip from looking from the past forward to looking from today to the past and reconstructing evolutionary trees by using DNA, using genetic data, initially small portions of the genome, and today, of course, we can apply whole genomic studies to understanding evolutionary relationships. So specifically, one of the things in terms of addressing human evolution that Alan's lab did and really brought to the public as well as to the scientific community was the concept of mitochondrial DNA, and using mitochondrial DNA to trace evolutionary relationships that gave us, in a sense, a much cleaner and simpler picture of past relationships. Because unlike nuclear DNA, which you inherit from both of your parents, you get 50% of your nuclear DNA from your mom and 50% from your dad, each contributing one of your two copies of your paired chromosomes. Mitochondrial DNA is passed down directly from mothers to their offspring. So all children inherit an exact copy of the mother's mitochondrial DNA. Nuclear DNA mixes each generation, you know, and so it's quite messy in a sense to try to reconstruct. So what Alan recognized is that the way that mitochondrial DNA is inherited, here you can see the egg, and here's the nucleus of the egg that has the chromosomal or the nuclear DNA, and the sperm down here with its nucleus and its nuclear DNA, and it has very few mitochondria compared to the egg, which has a lot of mitochondria. Mitochondria, of course, being the energy or powerhouse for the cell, involved in cell respiration and repair. So this, when the sperm fertilizes the egg, it introduces its nuclear DNA to the fertilized egg, But the mitochondria are right at the tail, they break off, and none of the paternal mitochondrial DNA is introduced to the fertilized egg. So the offspring that is generated from that fertilized egg only carries the mother's mitochondrial DNA. And mitochondrial DNA is a circular genome. It's about 16,500 bases long in humans, and it codes for 37 genes. So we can talk about the mitochondrial genome and mitochondrial DNA versus nuclear DNA, the DNA that is bound up in the chromosomes that you inherit from both of your parents. And what Alan and his team, his lab generally, they were working on a lot of different species, but two of his graduate students, Rebecca Kahn and Mark Stonking, and Alan, decided that they could apply this mitochondrial DNA study to try to understand the diversity of modern humans. And so they collected 182 samples from women who had ancestry from around the world. They were working in the United States, so they worked mostly with African American and Asian American, Native American, European American, and some Papuan populations from New Guinea. And they looked at the mitochondrial DNA of all of these women, and they reconstructed the evolutionary history. Looked how similar and different the DNA, the mitochondrial DNA sequences were from these women. And what they were able to reconstruct was the family tree or phylogeny of all that linked all modern human populations. And what they found were the deepest branches were found only in African-derived populations, African-Americans. And so they applied the molecular clock theory to this. So those were the oldest lineages were found in African populations. And the common ancestor to all modern humans, they dated to about 150,000 years ago. And then we see that all other populations from Asia, Australia, New Guinea, and Europe evolved out of that African population. And in particular, they found that it was related to a migration that occurred out of Africa about 60,000 years ago. And we see African lineages spread across the tree. So all of this was used to argue that basically we could all trace our ancestry back to a very recent African ancestor that lived between 150 and 200,000 years ago. That regional continuity model that Homo erectus in Asia evolved into Homo sapiens in Asia and really came out in strong support for the out-of-Africa migration, the replacement model where, yes, Homo erectus did move out 2 million years ago out of Africa, but that modern humans, Homo sapiens, evolved in Africa and then had, in a sense, a second out-of-Africa migration. So this just shows, again, confirming that when we're looking at mitochondrial DNA, we're looking at an ancestry purely on the maternal line. So it's DNA that you inherited from your mother, that she inherited from her mother, that she inherited from her mother. We can also now look at the Y chromosome, which is passed down through the paternal line. So we can get this nice, clean paternal history through looking at the Y chromosome of men, tracing it back through their father, grandfather, great-grandfather. But the thing that many people often forget is that you're as closely related to all of these ancestors of yours, your mother's father and your father's mother, but the mitochondrial DNA and the Y chromosome DNA lineages aren't telling you anything about those other ancestors. If you're looking at your nuclear DNA, you've inherited just as much of your nuclear DNA from all four of that generation. Again, it's when people get their results, they often think, oh, you know, but we were told we were related to some famous person in history, and often that may be because it's not showing up in the mitochondrial DNA because you inherited that trait from your mother's father rather than through the maternal line. So we've now, in 1987, that first mitochondrial tree was published by Alan Wilson and his students Becky Kahn and Mark Stonking, and that was based on a very limited amount of mitochondrial DNA. And since that time, since 1987, people have been collecting more and more samples, and the technology's improved significantly. So now we can sequence the entire mitochondrial genome, so all 16,500 base pairs, and we've collected more and more samples from around the world. And while those methods and the technology has been refined, the general structure of that basic tree that Alan Wilson presented in 1987 remains the same. And the dates, we're refining them, but it's still within that range where we see the most most recent common ancestor. You often see this was referred to as the MRCA, most recent common ancestor of all modern humans, dates to about 160,000 years ago, plus or minus 22,000 years, and the migration out of Africa when populations began to leave and populate Europe and Asia and the rest of the world began about 65,000 years ago, plus or minus 8,000 years ago. And so we can reconstruct both the timing and the structure by looking at the number of differences in the mitochondrial sequences. And we see on average, when we look at modern people today, that on average, there are about 70 changes in the genome, in the mitochondrial genome, 70 letter changes or base changes that take anybody back to the most recent common ancestor, and about 31 differences in the mitochondrial genome between non-African populations and the lineage that was the out of Africa lineage that left about 65,000 years ago. So, and if we want to look at chimpanzees and compare human to chimpanzees, we see there's about 1,283 differences between the human and the chimp mitochondrial genomes. So what's very interesting is while it was controversial at the time when the paper came out in 1987, we've now found from the fossil evidence that it's very, very consistent with these molecular dates that were determined by the Wilson team. So basically the earliest kind of, at this point, widely accepted evidence for the earliest fossil remains of Homo sapiens, they're dated to about 160,000 years ago in Ethiopia. And this fits very nicely with what we're seeing with the molecular data. Of course, some of you may have seen very recently in June of this year, 2017, that some fossil remains were found in Morocco that date to 300,000 years ago. And again, based on the morphology, they're looking very much like they are Homo sapiens, but people are still kind of debating and discussing, which is always the way that we build our data and evidence and test our hypotheses based on the fossil evidence. Unfortunately, we can't get any so far, and granted it's very early, but we don't have any DNA data from these individuals, so we can't compare it to Manu human mitochondrial DNA or nuclear DNA to determine the actual species. But based on the morphology, this is something that people are going to be talking about now for quite some time. So what do we know about out of Africa migrations based on this combination of the molecular data and the morphological data? We know that this migration out of Africa, we were often, it looked like maybe there were two routes of migration out. One kind of the southern route that goes through Ethiopia and into the Arabian Peninsula and through the southern part of Asia. And the second one that went kind of a northern route through Egypt and what is now Israel and Lebanon and Syria around the Eastern Mediterranean and up into Europe, but also into Asia. We now know from genomic evidence, looking at whole genome data and reconstructing, that there was probably a single exit out of Africa that went north through Egypt. And one of the ways that we know that it's likely that it was a northern route is based not only on modern genomes, but also on ancient genomic data, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But basically, when we look at mitochondrial DNA or Y chromosome DNA, we can reconstruct these phylogenies or family trees based on those DNA sequences. And so we have a number of different branches on the family tree, and each of these branches gets a kind of letter designation. And each of these branches we refer to in a molecular, from a molecular sense, as haplogroups, or groups of DNA sequences that share a recent common ancestor. So here we have a Z and a C lineage that share a common ancestor that comes back to a shared common ancestor further back here, which ultimately traces back to the mitochondrial Eve who is here. So we see these lineages here, the L lineages. Those are exclusively African lineages. And the out-of-Africa migration was an L3 lineage. And that splits very quickly, we see, into an M group and an N group. And the M lineages, we see primarily in Southern Asian populations and into Australia and the Pacific. And the N group goes north in almost all of the European, or many of the European lineages, and many of the Asian lineages are also belong to the N group. So we split these, and then the M splits up into these various letters, and C, D, M, E, G, and Q, where N breaks up into a large group of R lineages that share a common ancestry, and then they break up into, for example, the B lineages, which we see in the Pacific, F, H, R, P, T, J, U, K, and the N group, the A, I, W, X, Y, and old N lineages. And similarly, we can reconstruct our phylogeny for the Y chromosome as well, and talk about Y chromosome haplogroups. So how do we determine this? Well, by looking at the DNA sequences, what is that shared common mutation that links all individuals who belong to the M group or the N subgroup or the T lineage, for example? This is my DNA. I'm a T2B4, but I belong to the broader T haplogroup and T2 haplogroup. And because I have particular mutations at particular locations, that defines me as a T2 lineage. So at position 16126, for example, I have a C, and everybody who belongs to the T lineage has that same mutation. And if you don't have that mutation, you probably don't belong to the T lineage. So we can, by comparing all of the DNA sequences, start to see where mutations are shared, and therefore how we can place you on that family tree. And when we start looking at the distribution of those mutations and those haplogroups, those lineages across the globe, that helps us start to work out how populations moved, and we can apply the molecular clock theory to figure out when those populations kind of moved into different parts of the globe. And so we can see, for example, in some locations, for example, in the Americas, we have a limited number of haplogroups, A, B, in the Americas we have 5, A, B, C, D, and X. In the Pacific, we have limited diversity as well. And that tells us something about the numbers of people that left or that moved into that area as the original colonists. And often that's a subset of the broader population. So we can reconstruct these maps, and then from these maps start to reconstruct arrows of population migrations. And so we can start to reconstruct how people moved and understand when they moved by applying molecular clock theory. So what's been really interesting, of course, is that most of that work was going on since Ellen Wilson published his work in 1987. But the field of ancient DNA, again, which traces back to the Wilson lab, has really started to challenge some of our ideas. The modern human data, when we looked at modern mitochondrial DNA, clearly came out in favor of the out-of-Africa hypothesis, that was the way that modern humans evolved in Africa and moved around the rest of the globe. We started being able to actually get DNA out of ancient remains, and this again required both a lot of hard work, but also the development of new technologies. And most recently, just in the last probably 8 to 10 years, we've been able to get genomic data from ancient remains. And then therefore we can radiocarbon date those remains and sequence those, and we actually get a particular point in time that tells us about how populations are related to one another. And in 2010, we were able to generate the first draft sequence of the Neanderthal genome. So they were initially able to get DNA out of the original Neander Valley Neanderthal remains from Germany, and they were able to sequence a mitochondrial genome first of all, and then they were able actually to reconstruct a complete nuclear genome from the first Neanderthal. And generally, when we start thinking about species, depending on the definition that you use for a species, the kind of classic biological species definition is that we identify species that can't interbreed with one another, that they can't produce fertile offspring. And so we classified Homo sapiens as one species, and Neanderthal, Homo neanderthalensis, as the second species. But when we started looking at the full genome of the Neanderthal, what we actually found was all non-African populations carry, on average, about 2% of Neanderthal DNA in our genome. And at about the same time that we sequenced the Neanderthal genome, researchers were looking at some fossil remains from a cave in southern Siberia, and they found what they thought might have been Homo sapiens remains, might have been Neanderthal remains. They found a bit of a mole, they found a full molar and a bit of a phalange, a little bit of the and tip of the finger bone, and they thought they would sequence that to see whether it was Homo sapiens or Neanderthal remains. And what they actually found was it was neither. It was a group of hominins that shared a common ancestor with Neanderthal before Neanderthal and humans split from a common ancestor. So this was an amazing discovery. We don't have any more at this point of what was referred to as the denisovans, than a tooth and a little bit of the finger bone. So we can't actually determine whether it's a true species or not, but it is a population that is significantly different from Neanderthal and from modern humans. Interestingly, different populations carry a different amount of what is now being referred to as the denisovan DNA. So where all non-African populations carry Neanderthal DNA, only, for example, Asians and Melanesians carry a significant amount, and we're talking between 3 and 5% of denisovan DNA. So this, again, tells us something about where admixture was likely to have occurred. So if admixture is occurring with different earlier species, then we don't have a strict out-of-Africa replacement model, but we certainly have some kind of a mix between an out-of-Africa strict replacement and a regional continuity model. So the fact that all non-African populations carry a small amount of Neanderthal DNA tells us that probably that admixture occurred immediately after populations left Africa. So probably, and what we see from the archaeological record, is that in the Eastern Mediterranean, in Israel and Lebanon, we see both in cave deposits, both Homo sapiens and Neanderthal remains. That's probably where that admixture occurred. And then those admixed populations went on to establish across the globe, where the denisovan DNA probably occurred in southern Asia as those early out-of-African populations were moving through southern Asia and into Australia and New Guinea, and ultimately they go out into Melanesia, and that's probably where that admixture with denisovans occurred. So we now have, in a sense, a softened out-of-Africa migration that includes a certain amount of regional continuity where modern humans are indeed mixing with some earlier hominins in probably in Central or Southern Asia, but also all non-African populations, so the out-of-Africa population that moved down was having some admixture with Neanderthal as well. So it's very interesting. There's multiple events. We think as the research is accumulating, the data are accumulating, that there was a secondary mixture with Neanderthals probably in Asia as well, as certain Asian populations have a little bit more Neanderthal than, for example, European populations. So we know that humans left Africa, you know, about 65,000 years ago, a group of Africans left, and we talk about this, the Paleolithic period. By 40,000 years ago, they're up into Europe. 50,000 years ago, they're out into Australia, and possibly a little bit earlier in Asia. And we can see these mitochondrial lineages associated with these migrations. But things change quite a lot with the last major ice age, or the last glacial maximum that's dated to beginning about 22,000 years ago and finishing about 14,000 years ago. These major ice sheets come down and basically force people who are living in these areas into what we call refugia, or places that are warm enough that have enough food for them to live. And so we see populations pushed into the Iberian Peninsula and Spain and Portugal and parts of France, into Italy and into these refugia as well in the Near East. And they're isolated there for about 10,000 years. And so we see new mutations developing in each of these various geographic regions. And then as the ice sheets retreat, populations move out again and then they can start mixing. But we can start to trace some of these lineages back to particular geographic regions. The next kind of major event that we see that really changes the distribution of mitochondrial DNA and nuclear DNA as well, as we're beginning to see, was the Neolithic Revolution. So agriculture develops in the Fertile Crescent region over here in the Near East, begins about 12,000-13,000 years ago, and then beginning about 10,000 years ago, those farmers, they basically are reproducing, having larger families, reproducing faster than the hunter-gatherer populations who were living elsewhere, and they move out into Western Europe and also out of the Fertile Crescent eastwards into Asia. And what we've started seeing, and again, we had a bit of a debate, do we have a replacement model where these farming populations replace the hunter-gatherers in Europe, or do we have emerging? Are people introducing new ideas of farmers and the hunter-gatherers are picking it up? But we can see the time movement of people across Europe beginning, as I say, about 10,000 years ago until about 6,000 years ago when they reach the British Isles. And what we've actually started to see from the ancient DNA by looking at the DNA of hunter-gatherers in Europe and the DNA of farmers in Europe, these are ancient remains, we see that we actually have a full replacement of the hunter-gatherer, not a full replacement, but a significant replacement of the hunter-gatherers by the farming populations. So even when we look at movement into Europe or into Asia, we have multiple migrations. The early 45,000 years ago migration, then they get pushed down during the Ice Ages, then 7,000 years ago, the agriculturalists are coming out of the Fertile Crescent through Turkey or Anatolia, as it referred to, and into Southern Europe. And then it looks like now we actually have another Neolithic expansion, this time associated with the people who had the wheel coming in after 7,000 years ago. So maybe 4,500-5,000 years ago, we have a secondary movement through more Northern Europe into Western Europe. So we're getting quite a complex picture based on genomic DNA, so looking at DNA of the whole genome, where we can actually start to reconstruct these migrations and see these kind of layers of populations through time. We've done a lot of work now in Europe, and we're starting to get similar information for Asia, as well as figuring out what's happening, for example, in the Pacific region. And then, of course, modern people being who we are, we're starting to migrate even more. So today, when we start looking at the variation that we see in populations, we're a complete mix with the result of modern mobility. And you know, several hundred years ago, you were raised in a village, in the same village that your parents were raised in, and so forth. Today, we're spread across the globe. So of course, we're seeing even more of this kind of mixing and layering of different populations. So just to conclude, we all share a recent common ancestor in Africa, dated to between 150 and 200,000 years ago. Maybe if we start looking at some of the new fossil evidence, it could be possibly a bit more. It's neither a strict out-of-Africa or a regional continuity model, but what we seem to have is kind of a soft, a relaxed out-of-Africa model with evidence of admixture with Neanderthal and with Denisovans. That human history is shaped by numerous physical and cultural events, for example, the last glacial maximum and the spread of agriculture, historic plagues and things that resulted in major population crashes, for example, major military invasions, all of these things are affecting the genetic makeup of different populations around the globe, and we're learning more and more all the time, so that we really do have to be able to be flexible and revise our hypotheses, and that really is the nature of the scientific method. So it's a pretty exciting time to be studying human evolution, to be studying genetics and genomics, and trying to figure out what's going on in our past so we can determine where we're going in the future. So that's the end of it. And I'd just like to thank all of you for participating and watching these lectures.